Welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the cytoskeleton in human cells, and in part one, I'm going to be talking about microtubules. Cells have a lot of structures in them, and when we draw one, we'll usually include the plasma membrane, the nucleus, some endoplasmic reticulum, ribosomes, Golgi apparatus, vesicles, lysosomes, peroxisomes, mitochondria. What maintains the cell shape and structure? What helps transport these vesicles and organelles around the cytoplasm? Those are just some of the few functions that the cell cytoskeleton has. Like how bones of the human skeleton provide structure to the body, the cell has a skeleton of its own. That's the cytoskeleton. So the cytoplasm has these protein filaments and tubules running through it that form the cell cytoskeleton. There are three important groups of them. There are microtubules, intermediate filaments, and microfilaments. Microtubules have the largest diameter, and microfilaments have the smallest. In this video, we're going to take a look at microtubules, and in part two, we'll look at the other two. With a diameter of around 25 nanometers, these are the largest cytoskeletal structures. They are heterodimers, so they have two different subunits called tubulins, microtubules, tubulins. Alpha and beta. Now these dimers, they get stacked one above the other, forming a protofilament. These then form a cylinder with a hollow center. So this circle, it'll have around 13 subunits, and the subunits are forming the wall. Since they have this kind of structured orientation, they are polar structures. One end is positive and the other end is negative. By adding these dimers to the microtubule, it can lengthen. That's polymerization, and it's assembling the microtubule. By removing dimers, it can shorten. That's depolymerization, and it's causing disassembly. This happens faster at the plus end than the minus end. This lengthening and shortening from assembly and disassembly that the microtubules can do is dynamic instability. It actually depends on the rate of GTP hydrolysis. The units that are bound to GTP, they bind tightly. But when that GTP gets hydrolyzed to GDP, the dimers have a lower affinity. So if the rate of assembly is faster than the rate of hydrolysis, then the structure will lengthen. Microtubules are formed in microtubule organizing centers. More familiarly, that would be the centrosome. Centrosomes consist of two centrioles, which are these cylindrical bodies arranged perpendicular to each other, and they're surrounded by pericentriolar material. I'm sure as soon as I said centrioles, the first thing you'd think about is cell division, mitosis, meiosis, and the spindles. Those spindle fibers, they are microtubules, which have their negative ends towards the centrioles and positive ends radiating outwards. There are three different kinds of spindle fibers. The astral microtubules radiate out towards the cortex of the cell. The kinetochore microtubules attach to the kinetochores of the sister chromatids. The last kind are the polar microtubules. Now, they don't attach to the chromosomes, but overlap at the center. Now, together, these microtubules help align chromatids at the center so that they can split and move towards the opposite poles. If we take a cross-section of a centriole, meaning we cut it in half and look at it from above, it has 9 sets of microtubules. Now, this is a simplified version. The whole thing would actually look like a cartwheel with all those radial spokes, but we just need the microtubules right now. Each set is a triplet, so that's 3 microtubules, A, B, and C. The A tubule is complete with 13 units, but B and C are incomplete, with around 11 each. So there's 9 triplets in a centriole. Similar to the structure of centrioles is the structure of cilia. Now cilia could be motile or immotile. Here we're going to be talking about motile cilia, which are these hair-like structures on the surface of epithelial cells in some parts of the body, like the upper respiratory tract and the fallopian tubes. Now they move fluid and structures along the passages that they line. They do that with whip-like movements. There's a fast forward stroke, which moves the fluid, and a slow backward stroke to repeat the same thing again. They arise from the cell membrane from a basal body, Now, this is just beneath the membrane. This basal body is similar to the centriole. It's where the microtubules of the cilia originate from. If we take a cross-section of a cilium, again we see the microtubule arrangement, 9 doublets at the periphery, each one having one complete microtubule, which has 13 units, and one incomplete microtubule, with 11 units. So these are doublets, they are not triplets like in the centriole. Also, there are 2 complete microtubules in the center. That wasn't there in a centriole. So this is a 9+2 arrangement. The central and the outer tubules are connected by radial spokes, and the outer tubules, in between them, they've got 2 kinds of links. The first is nexin. Now, nexin is the protein between the outer tubule sets. The second link is dynein. There are dynein arms associated with each set. Dynein is a molecular motor protein. It's an ATPase, so it hydrolyzes ATP and uses the energy to do what? To bend the cilium. Remember, we're talking about motile cilia. Those ciliary movements are because of dynein. It makes the outer tubules slide on one another so that the cilia bend. If there's a defect in the dynein arms, there can be a problem with ciliary motility. For example, in primary ciliary dyskinesia, there can be a defect of the dynein arm. Now, what's a structure that's very similar to cilia? Flagella. They too have microtubules, but the only flagellated cell in humans is the sperm cell. Again, they help with motility. So microtubules are a part of cilia, flagella, and we also saw how they're important for cell division. Dynein helped movement of the cilia, but there's also a cytoplasmic dynein, as well as kinesin. Now, these are molecular motor proteins that help movement of structures along the microtubules. The best place to understand that is with axonal transport in a neuron. The axon of neurons has an axolemma, that's the plasma membrane, and the cytoplasm is called the axoplasm. So microtubules are going to help with axoplasmic transport, because movement along the axon happens either from the cell body to the synaptic terminals or the other way around. Now, what they transport could be proteins, vesicles, organelles, all lumped together under the term cargo. Now, this cargo can move in either direction, but it happens along the microtubules. Remember how the microtubules are polar? In the axon, the positive end is towards the synaptic terminals and the negative end is towards the cell body. Movement towards the synaptic terminal is orthograde or anterograde transport, and that uses kinesin, from minus to plus. Now, one end of kinesin would bind to the microtubule and the other end to the cargo. Retrograde transport is from the terminals to the cell body, and that uses dynein, from plus to minus. These are both ATPases, so they hydrolyze ATP and they use that energy to move cargo in either direction. Kinesin for anterograde transport, dynein for retrograde transport. So microtubules help with intracellular transport. So it's got a lot of functions, and all of it is in addition to providing structural support to the cell. Like kinesin and dynein, there is a third family of molecular motor proteins, myosin. Now, these are usually associated with actin filaments, you know, actin and myosin. Actin filaments are microfilaments. That's our next group. So we'll be talking about microfilaments and intermediate filaments in part 2. I hope this video helped you. If it did, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.